Welcome back to the Million Dollar Problems. If you've been with us from the start, you'll recall how we tackled the enigmatic Riemann hypothesis in episode one, explored the Birch and Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture in episode two, and delved into Yang-Mills and the mass gap in episode three. Today, we're turning our focus to a problem that flows through mathematics, physics, and engineering, the Navier-Stokes equation. I've got to admit, my first brush with the Navier-Stokes equations wasn't in a classroom or a textbook. It was through a movie named Gifted. Ever heard about it?
Oh, absolutely. That's the one with Chris Evans and McKenna Grace, right? I haven't seen it, though. What did I miss?
Right. McKenna Grace plays Mary, this brilliant young girl who's a mathematical prodigy, and she's being raised by her Uncle Frank, played by Chris Evans. The whole thing revolves around her late mom, Diane, who was obsessed with solving the Navier-Stokes equations. It's like this shadow over their lives. Watching that, I couldn't stop thinking, these equations, why are they such a big deal?
I think that movie hints at something real about the equations. Their mystique, the way they've stumped some of the brightest minds for generations. The Navier-Stokes equations describe how fluids move, whether it's water flowing through a pipe or air swirling around a plane.
I mean, we've had these equations for centuries, right? Haven't we?
We have. In 1822, Claude-Louis Navier presented the first version of what we now call the Navier-Stokes equations. Navier was an engineer who thought about fluids as collections of particles influenced by forces of attraction and repulsion. His ideas were groundbreaking, but incomplete. Then came George Gabriel Stokes, who, in the mid-19th century, refined Navier's equations to account for the viscosity of fluids more rigorously. Together, their work formed the foundation of modern fluid dynamics. Navier and Stokes stood on the shoulders of giants. Isaac Newton laid the groundwork with his laws of motion, and Leonhard Euler followed up with equations for ideal non-viscous fluids. Euler's equations captured the elegance of fluid motion, but ignored the messy reality of viscosity. That's where Navier-Stokes comes in, adding viscosity into the equation to describe real-world fluids.
It's like they're connecting the dots across generations.
Exactly. And throughout history, some brilliant contributors refine these equations. Augustin-Louis Cauchy, Simeon-Denis Poisson, and Adhemar Barra de Saint-Venant all made important advances in elasticity and fluid mechanics that influenced the development of these equations. By the time Stokes came along, he had a wealth of ideas to build on.
So why did it take so long to get to the equations we know today?
Part of it was the sheer complexity of the problem. Early on, there wasn't a clear understanding of how to handle viscosity mathematically. Navier approached it using molecular theories, which were innovative for the time, but hard to formalize. Stokes, on the other hand, brought in experimental insights and continuity arguments to refine the equations. And even then, they were solving specific cases, not tackling the full generality of fluid motion.
And here we are, almost 200 years later, still trying to solve the problem.
That's right, and turbulence, the chaotic, unpredictable flow of fluids, makes it even harder. Richard Feynman famously called turbulence the most important unsolved problem of classical physics. But solving these would transform how we understand and predict fluid behavior. Better weather forecasting, safer airplanes, more efficient engines, even medical breakthroughs in understanding blood flow.
It's incredible how much these equations impact.
That's why they're one of the Millennium Prize problems. So let's dive right into it. Imagine a tranquil stream flowing smoothly over polished stones. Its motion is serene, almost predictable. Now, picture that same water cascading into a rocky gorge, breaking apart into erratic swirls and crashing violently against unseen obstacles. The difference between these two states? that quiet harmony and this untamed chaos, is turbulence. Turbulence is the great mystery at the heart of the Navier-Stokes equation, a force of nature that transforms fluid motion into a dynamic, ever-shifting puzzle. It is beautiful, terrifying, and to this day defies complete mathematical comprehension.
So turbulence, this unruly behavior, is the reason the Navier-Stokes equation has baffled mathematicians for centuries?
Precisely. At its core, the Navier-Stokes equation is deceptively simple, a mathematical framework designed to describe how fluids move. It governs the motion of air, water, and even more exotic flows like plasma or lava. What the Clay Mathematics Institute asks is this: can we prove, beyond any doubt, whether these equations always yield smooth, predictable solutions? Or do they inevitably break down under certain conditions, producing singularities, points where the mathematics spirals into infinity? The equation itself takes the form of partial differential equations, blending Newton's second law of motion with the principles of fluid mechanics. It describes how velocity, pressure, and external forces interact to shape the flow of a fluid. Yet when turbulence enters the picture, things become maddeningly complex. Turbulence is not merely disorder, it is a cascade. Energy flows from large, sweeping motions into smaller and smaller eddies until it dissipates as heat. This fractal-like process is governed by chaos, making it nearly impossible to predict the motion of every molecule.
So turbulence is like a storm within a storm, with each gust giving rise to smaller, unpredictable ripples?
Exactly. Terence Tao, one of the greatest living mathematicians, compared the equations to trying to model a storm while it's happening, a task that's as daunting as it sounds. This cascade, what we call the turbulence cascade, is where the Navier-Stokes equation meets its most formidable challenge. Mathematicians struggle because this cascade introduces scales of motion so fine, so intricate, that controlling or even describing them becomes an insurmountable task. To put it in perspective, solving Navier-Stokes for turbulence would be akin to predicting the movement of every grain of sand in a desert storm. Every gust, every collision, every shift. This brings us to the heart of the problem. The Clay Institute's challenge isn't just about turbulence, it's about existence and smoothness. Existence asks whether the equations always yield a solution for every initial condition, a map of motion that never falters. Smoothness questions whether this solution remains free from singularities. In simpler terms, can we guarantee that a fluid never behaves so erratically that the equations themselves fail to hold?
It sounds like the universe itself is conspiring to keep this mystery unsolved. How has the progress been?
Progress is there, yes, but breakthroughs remain elusive. For decades, mathematicians have made strides under special conditions. For example, we know that the equations work beautifully in two dimensions. That's why weather patterns, which can often be approximated in 2D, are predictable, at least in the short term. But when we move to three dimensions, the world of vortices and turbulence erupts, and the rules that govern stability unravel. In three dimensions, the equations become what we call supercritical. Imagine trying to balance a broomstick on your palm. In two dimensions, it's manageable. But add a third axis, and the challenge multiplies exponentially. Energy begins to concentrate in smaller and smaller regions, cascading into scales so fine they elude control. It is like a magnifying glass. As you zoom in, the complexity doesn't diminish, it amplifies. There have been milestones, of course. In 1934, Jean Leray established the existence of weak solutions, approximations that describe the behavior of fluids without requiring absolute precision. More recently, mathematicians have explored regularity, the idea that under certain constraints, smooth solutions might persist. Charles Pfefferman, who formalized the Clay problem, and others have pushed the boundaries of what we understand about singularities. And then there's the work of physicists, who simulate turbulence with increasing precision, offering glimpses into its chaotic dance.
Any signs that a solution is within reach?
The landscape is littered with partial victories. For instance, researchers have proven smoothness under certain initial conditions or in constrained systems. But these are narrow corridors within a vast, uncharted territory. What remains unsolved is the general case, the Navier-Stokes equation in its full three-dimensional glory. It's hard because nature itself is hard to pin down. Let's start with what Terence Tao calls the equation's greatest defiance, their behavior at the finest scales. As energy cascades through turbulence, it fragments into smaller and smaller vortices, infinitely intricate. Tao once said, the equations defy control at their finest scales. And he's right. Imagine zooming in on a fractal. Every layer reveals a new complexity, no end in sight. Mathematically, this comes down to what we call supercriticality. At smaller scales, the equations lose their grip, and energy flows toward singularities, points where the equations essentially break. To solve Navier-Stokes, we'd need to show that these singularities either never form or can be tamed within certain bounds. But no one has found a way to do this. Then there is also a challenge of scaling about how the equations respond to changes in size or energy. Imagine stretching and compressing a fluid. A small perturbation can spiral into chaos. And this chaos isn't random. It follows patterns we're only beginning to understand.
That sounds daunting, but surely we've made progress?
We have. As I mentioned earlier, in two dimensions, for instance, the equations behave beautifully. Solutions exist and remain smooth. That's why oceanographers can model large-scale currents with reasonable accuracy. But the moment we add the third dimension, the entire system becomes vastly more complex. Computational methods have also made strides, simulating turbulence with astonishing precision. But simulations are not proofs.
So imagine for a moment what solving this problem would mean. What breakthrough will we achieve then?
This will transform our understanding of fluids and motions. Weather prediction, for instance, hinges on Navier-Stokes. Imagine forecasting hurricanes accurately days in advance, or predicting monsoons weeks before they arrive. Then, ocean currents shape climate systems, govern marine ecosystems, and even influence fisheries. Navier-Stokes is the key to modeling these flows with unprecedented detail. Then, there are more ambitious applications. Flying cars, for example, designing vehicles that seamlessly navigate air currents requires mastering turbulence, or tsunami prediction. Understanding how energy propagates through water could save lives by giving earlier warnings.
It's fascinating how this touches everything from the sky to the sea and yet remains unsolved. Perhaps that's what makes it so captivating.
Mathematics has always been about connection. It connects ideas to reality, logic to imagination. Solving Navier-Stokes would be more than a mathematical triumph. It would be a philosophical one. It would show us that even the most chaotic systems have underlying order. I think the beauty of mathematics lies in its persistence. Even if a solution eludes us for another century, the journey itself will illuminate new paths. And who knows? Perhaps someone listening to this very discussion will one day hold the key.